Good morning. Welcome to the Unitarian Universalist Church of Canandaigua. I am so glad to be with you this morning at our virtual worship service. I'm Eileen, I'm your minister. And before we begin, I have just a few quick announcements to share. I'm going to share my screen so that you can see them. The first, and this is the last time that I promise, this last time I'll tell you this, we're having a pie sale fundraiser for the church this month. And we're still looking for a few last pie bakers who would like to bake some pies to offer up to be sold to benefit our church. And a few skilled drivers, licensed drivers, who'd like to make some deliveries. If you can help with either of those things, would you please contact Pat Mells? Her email address is on your screen, and I'll put it in the chat box as well. If you are a pie eater and you've just been waiting for your turn to help the church, you want to purchase some pie, next week, I promise, it'll be your turn. And then I want to let you know that we have now an expanded pastoral care team. I want to thank these folks for joining our expanded pastoral care team. We have Scobie Beer, Kevin House, Pat Mells, Nancy Reed, in addition to myself, who are going to be providing pastoral care for us as a congregation. And a little more preemptively in this time when we're not able to be together. So you should hear from one of these people in the next few weeks, just to check in and see how you're doing. Especially if you haven't been to church in a while, or we're not sure what's going on with you, you'll hear from one of these folks just to check in and see if there's anything you need to talk about. If there's something you need to talk about and you can't wait, please give me a call or one of these folks on our team. We'd be glad to listen. And then I'm gonna put a link in our chat. But we want to know how religious education is going. We're trying something new. It's virtual this year. We have a family chapel and some at-home activities. And we've got a quick survey as we're partway through the year, almost finished with our first curriculum, to see how is it going for you. So if you're a religious education family and you've been participating, let us know. Please fill out the survey. It should only take a couple minutes. And then one last announcement is that if you are a visitor with us today, I'm posting in the chat now a link to our virtual guest book. So if it's your first time, or you haven't been around for a while, or you're not yet a member, but you've been maybe thinking about it, go ahead and click that link and fill out our virtual guest book. We'd love to be able to stay in touch with you. The other links pertaining to the announcements are showing up in your chat now as well. Let's take a deep breath in and enter a space of worship together. If you have a chalice, now is the time for lighting our chalices. And as we light them, we'll recite our chalice lighting words. We gather this hour as people of faith, with joys and sorrows, gifts and needs. We light this beacon of hope, sign of our quest for truth and meaning, in celebration of the life we share together. Friends, my Aunt Mary Lou loves to tell this story. It's a story of a man, maybe you've heard it, of a man who wishes or prays, maybe, to know what heaven and hell are like. And it's granted to him. He has this vision of a large banquet hall. This is how she tells it. with people seated around a table. The table is full of all the best foods and drinks imaginable. And he thinks, this must be heaven. Then he approaches, he gets a little closer and sees that everyone's arms are stilted and they can't bend at the elbow. So they sit staring, starving at the feast on the table, but cannot bring food or drink to their mouths. He realizes, oh, this is hell. And then a second vision comes to him. He assumes it's heaven, but he sees it's the same room with a table laid out with all the same wonderful food and drink and people sitting around it, arms stilted and unable to bend. He wonders if maybe it's just another level of hell. And then he gets closer and notices that here, the people are laughing and talking as they lift their stilted arms and feed one another. The difference between heaven and hell is in the choices that they make. And if that's not why we come to church, then I just don't know what is. This is a community where we remind one another that how we live matters. It matters more maybe than anything else. The world we build together matters more than the world that is handed to us. We don't know what happens when we die, but we know for certain that a life together with care for our neighbors and trust that they'll care for us is all the heaven we need. Will you join with me in singing our first hymn this morning, Woke Up This Morning? Share a picture with you while we tell the story. This. Okay, my picture doesn't want to share while we tell the story. I'll share a picture with you after we tell the story. This is a story you've probably heard before, and it is a story called The Emperor's New Clothes by Hans Christian Andersen, and this translation is by Jean Herschelt. Many years ago, there was an emperor so exceedingly fond of new clothes that he spent all his money on being well-dressed. He cared for nothing about reviewing his soldiers, going to the theater, or going for a ride in his carriage, except to show off his clothes. He had a coat for every hour of the day, and instead of saying, as one might about any ruler, the kings in his council, here they always said, the emperors in his dressing room. In the great city where he lived, life was always joyful. Every day, many strangers came to town, and among them one day came two swindlers. They let it be known that they were weavers, and they said they could weave the most magnificent fabrics imaginable. Not only were their colors and patterns uncommonly fine, but clothes made of this cloth had a wonderful way of becoming invisible to anyone who was unfit for their office or anyone who was unusually stupid. Those would be just the clothes for me, thought the emperor. If I wore them, I would be able to discover which of the people in my empire are unfit for their posts, and I could tell the wise folks from the fools. Yes, I must certainly get some of the stuff woven for me right away. He paid the two swindlers a large sum of money and started to work at once. They set up two looms and they pretended to weave, though there was nothing on the looms. All the finest silk and the purest thread which they demanded went right into their traveling bags while they worked the empty looms far into the night. I'd like to know how those weavers are getting on with the cloth, the emperor thought, but he felt slightly uncomfortable when he remembered that those who were unfit for their position would not be able to see the fabric. It couldn't have been that he doubted himself, yet he thought he'd rather send someone else to see how things were going. The whole town knew about the cloth's particular power, and they were impatient to find out how stupid their neighbors might be. I'll send my honest old minister to the weavers, the emperor decided. He'll be the one best to tell me how the material looks, for he's a sensible man and he does his duty well. So the honest old minister went into the room where the two swindlers sat working away at their empty looms. Heaven help me, he thought as his eyes flew wide open. I can't see anything at all. But he did not say so. Both the swindlers begged him to be kind as to come near and approve of the excellent pattern, the beautiful colors. They pointed to the empty looms and the poor old minister stared as hard as he dared. He couldn't see anything because there was nothing to see. Heaven have mercy, he thought. Can it be that I'm a fool? I'd have never guessed it, and not a soul must know. Am I unfit to be the minister? I would never do to let on that I can't see the cloth. Don't hesitate to tell us what you think of it, said one of the weavers. Oh, it's beautiful. It's enchanting, the old minister peered through his spectacles. Such a pattern. What colors? I'll be sure to tell the emperor how delighted I am. We're pleased to hear it, the swindlers said. They proceeded to name all the colors and explain the intricate pattern. The old minister paid closest attention so that he could tell it all to the emperor, and so he did. The swindlers at once asked for more money, more silk, and gold thread to get on with their weaving, but it all went into their pockets. Not a thread went onto the looms. The emperor presently sent another trustworthy official to see how the work progressed and how soon it would be ready. The same thing happened to him that had happened to the minister. He looked and he looked, but there was nothing to see in the looms. He couldn't see anything. Isn't it a beautiful piece of goods? The swindler asked him, and they displayed it and described their imaginary pattern. I know I'm not stupid, the man thought, so it must be I'm unworthy of my good office. I mustn't let anyone find out. So he praised the material he did not see. He declared he was delighted with the beautiful colors and the exquisite pattern. To the emperor, he said, it held me spellbound. All the town was talking of this splendid cloth, and the emperor wanted to see it for himself while it was still in the looms, attended by a band of chosen men, among whom were two of his oldest trusted officials, the ones who had been to the weavers. He set out to see the two swindlers. He found them weaving with might and with main, but without a thread in their looms. Magnificent, said the two officials, already duped. Just look, your majesty, what colors, what a design. They pointed to the empty looms, each supposing the others could see the stuff. "What's this?" thought the emperor. "This is terrible. I can't see anything. Am I a fool? Am I unfit to be the emperor? What a thing to happen to me of all people." What he said was, "It has my highest approval." And he nodded to the empty loom. Nothing could make him see that he couldn't see anything. Everyone stared and stared. One saw no more than another, but they all joined the emperor in exclaiming, "Oh, it's very pretty." And they advised him to wear the clothes made of this wonderful cloth for the great procession he was soon to lead. The emperor gave each of the swindlers a cross to wear in his buttonhole and the title of Sir Weaver. Before the procession, the swindlers sat up all night and burned more than 6 candles to show how busy they were finishing the emperor's new clothes. They pretended to take the cloth off the loom. They made cuts in the air with huge scissors. And at last they said, "Now the emperor's new clothes are ready for him." Then the emperor himself came with his noblest nobleman, and the swindlers each raised an arm as if they were holding something. They said, "These are the trousers, here's the coat, and this is the mantle," naming each garment. All of them light as spider web. One would almost think he had nothing on, but that's what makes them so fine. "Exactly," the noblemen agreed, although they could see nothing, for there was nothing to see. "If your majesty would condescend to take your clothes off," said the swindlers, "we will help you on with your new ones here in front of the mirror." The emperor undressed, and the swindlers pretended to put new clothes on him, one garment after another. "How your majesty's new clothes look! Aren't they becoming?" he heard on all sides. "The pattern so perfect, the colors so suitable. It is a magnificent outfit." Then the minister of public processions announced, "Your majesty's canopy is awaiting outside." "Well, I'm supposed to be ready," the emperor said, and turned for one last look in the mirror. "It is a remarkable fit, isn't it?" He seemed to regard his costume with the greatest interest. The noblemen who were to carry his train stooped low and reached for the floor as if they were picking it up. They pretended to lift and hold it high. They didn't dare admit they had nothing to hold. So off went the emperor in procession under his splendid canopy. Everyone in the streets and the windows said, "Oh, how fine are the emperor's new clothes. Don't they fit him to perfection? And see how his long train glides." Nobody would confess that they couldn't see anything, for that would prove them either unfit for their position or a fool. No costume the emperor had worn before was such a complete success. "But," a little child cried, "but he hasn't got anything on." "Did you ever hear such innocent prattle?" said his father. And one person whispered to another what the child had said. "He hasn't got anything on." "A child says he hasn't got anything on." "He hasn't got anything on," the whole town cried at last. And this is the end of our story. And now is the time in our service when we share the deepest feelings on our hearts with one another. This is a community where we hold one another in our greatest joys and in our deepest sorrows. And now is our time to share in the chat, as you will, what joys and sorrows are on your hearts this morning. I invite you to share here now in our chat what it is that you're holding today. This morning, we hold in our hearts so much joy, the hope that things will be okay. We hold in our hearts the promise of a new day, a weight lifted, the release of our tension. Gratitude for the Julians and for all poll workers and for everyone dedicated to the project of democracy. The gift of sharing our joy with one another's. The hope of healing, of building connection and understanding as we move forward. We hold these and any of the joys and sorrows silent in our hearts together, and know that as you hold these, we are with you. And I'd like to invite you now into the spiritual practice of generosity. It's time for our morning's plate offering. I ask you this morning to give to our church as generously as you're able, knowing that it is your gifts that fund the good work of this community. There are a couple of ways that you can give, and I will post them in the chat now. You can go to our website and give online. There's a link in the chat. Or you can mail a check to the church at 3024 Cooley Road in Canandaigua. Our beloved treasurer tells me that you might consider making an automatic gift through your bank account. If, I don't know, like me, you're someone who thinks every Sunday now that we're here virtually, oh, I should put something in the plate, and then forgets about it at about 11:15. You could set up an automatic plate gift with your bank if that's what's right for you and your forgetful brain, like it is for me. In any case, if you make a note that your gift is intended for the weekly worship offering, a quarter of it will be shared with our service partner. And our service partner this month is Ganondagan. We thank you for your generosity this morning. And now let's enter into a time of centering, followed by some shared silence. Get comfortable in your seat. Let's take a breath in and let it out with a long exhale. We needed to exhale, didn't we? Breathe in deep and release it in a slow breath out. How long have you been holding your breath? Since Tuesday? Breathe in and let it out with a sigh. Since March, inhale and exhale with a louder sigh. For 4 years, for 40, take a refreshing breath in and let it go with a sigh so loud it's nearly a shout. You're muted, you're allowed. In fact, maybe it's just what you need, catharsis, relief, the softening of the shoulders, the neck, the jaw. Breathe in and exhale right out loud. No doubt it's a shout now. Maybe no one told you. Maybe we all forgot for a minute, for a week, a year, a decade, half a life. We are allowed to shout. Breathe in, shout out. We are allowed to holler at God, at life, at the universe, for the unfairness of it all. Take a breath in and shout it out loud. We are allowed to roar with jubilation. Rejoice at the beauty of it all. Breathe in deep, friends, and loud because we're allowed. Let it out with all the what the hell, hallelujah, glorious, glad, terrified, furious, hopeful noise you have in you. Let it out.
Thank you.
Well, here we are. What a week, am I right? I waited until the last possible moment to write this sermon, which, as a rule, my beloved lay preachers, I do not recommend for the sake of your own sanity or the quality of our worship, but I was waiting for resolution. I kept refreshing the browser windows of NPR and 538, thinking I'd finally feel settled or something when we knew which way this election was going to go. And I'll be brutally honest about my own lack of insight. It wasn't until midday yesterday that I realized I was waiting for the wrong thing. The winner of the presidential election has become clear, but the way it is going, is going to unfold for a while now. The current president is going to keep stoking discord and violence for the rest of his life, probably. I am reminded of the frightening truth that the time after leaving an abuser is the most dangerous period for a victim of domestic violence. There is the inconvenient truth that nearly half of us signed up for 4 more years of fascism, making this election a practical and political triumph, but a loss in terms of a moral referendum. Donald Trump is a symptom of the disease, and it's good. It's oh so good to be relieved of this particular symptom. But our country is infected, as it has been from the very beginning, with the disease of white nationalism. So the way it's going is still unclear. And me feeling settled, dear God, what a wrong-headed thing to hope for. Complacent, that's really how I wanted to feel. Complacency is so comfortable. And the election results have tipped in such a way that I could, we all could probably sink into some really cozy complacency now, like an old pair of sweatpants. I'm so sorry to tell you, that's not our job as a church. By all means, take a minute. Be joyful. Exhale that breath you've been holding for 4 years. Go and dance in the street. Clang the pots and pans. It is absolutely our job as a church to oust tyrants from seats of power. And for perhaps the first time in history, an actual real deal fascist will have been unseated democratically. We can pop some champagne about that. And when we've finished our glasses, easing into 4 years of ignorant bliss is not what we're called to do as a people of faith. The calling of the church is not to ensure that the right man or even the least evil man sits in the seat of power. The calling of the church is not to relax when the person in the seat of power looks and speaks like us. The calling of the church is and always has been to speak truth to power. The earliest Christian churches didn't want to replace Caesar with a ruler slightly more amenable to their plight. The writings to one another are filled with resistance, not to one guy, but to the very idea of empire. I don't know about you, but I've spent the last week in a deep anxiety spiral of electoral math. And let me tell you, I did not go into this profession because I enjoy math. Like many of you, I've spent the last 4 days, 4 years really, angry at the idea of the Electoral College, angry that we're saddled with an undemocratic method of political engagement that was created to appease 18th century slave owners, annoyed because maybe a small elite group of rich white college boys from 2 centuries ago did not have it in them to create the most just structures for a society. There's something the people have been chanting in the streets here in Rochester as they call for justice in the face of police brutality. As one elected official after another vows to investigate potential wrongdoing, potential guilt on the part of maybe one or two officers, the people in the streets call out, "The whole damn system is guilty as hell." It's not our job as a church to put better people in seats of power. It's our job as a church to say that power corrupts even the best, that the blueprints of the empire are faulty, and of course, whatever we build out of them will be too. It's our job yesterday and today and tomorrow to speak the truth of justice to the empire, whomever Caesar is, to say with the people in the streets, the whole damn system is guilty as hell. It was our job to speak to President Trump the truth that his white supremacy is abhorrent, that the construction of prison camps on our borders and the use of them to detain innocent people, including children, is a moral abomination. It was also our job to speak the truth to President Obama that drone strikes killing hundreds of civilians, many of them children, were deplorable. It was our job to say to him that utilizing the National Guard to violently end a protest by indigenous people on their own land was an ethical disgrace. It will be our job to speak moral truths to President Biden as well. Few here this morning will dispute that he is a better person than his predecessor. It is not our job to ally ourselves with better people in the seats of power. It is our job to protect the vulnerable from the tyranny of that power, whomever wields it. Dietrich Bonhoeffer, a German theologian who spoke truth to power in the form of Hitler and who was executed for it, put it this way. The obligation of the church, he said, is not just to bandage the victims under the wheel of the state, but to jam a spoke in the wheel itself. No one has ever accused me of being too cheerful, but I promise I'm not here to cut off your rejoicing at the knees this week. What I hope to do is make room for a deeper and more meaningful joy, because I am so proud that we utilized the power of the vote this week. It is only one small fragment of the power of the people. This one choice on this one day is one of the least significant political acts we take. We also have at our disposal the power of the boycott, the power of the strike, the power of the protest, the power of organizing ourselves into communities that matter. I am joyful today because the greatest truth we speak to power, the truest truth, is this. It is not one executive in Washington who creates a just world. It is not nine justices in Washington who create a just world. It is not even 535 legislators, 50 state governments, innumerable mayors and town councils and city clerks who create a just world. We do not hang the hope of justice on these shoulders. We do not entrust it to a single checkmark on a ballot every few years. We carry it ourselves. The shape of justice is not a government, certainly not an empire. The shape of justice is a community. The shape of justice is a community where the people organize themselves by principles of fairness, respect, and love, where we lay down our joys and our sorrows to be held by one another, where we offer care and concern for each life among us, where we make promises that bind us to return again and again to be reconciled to one another. A community where we live out the truth of our belonging to each other. And here we are doing just that, holding one another in love and trusting that we ourselves will be held. Is a radical act of resistance to a system of power that tells us we are alone. To live in community is a rejection of the lie of individualism, that we must scrape by on our own and anyone who can't is a failure. To live in community is to make our lives an act of truth that power cannot ignore. No one who sits in the seat of power is going to save us. But the good news is we are saving one another. Over the rise and fall of every empire, may it be so. Amen.
Come by the fire, lay down your head. My love, I see you're growing tired, so set the bad day by the bed and rest a while. Your eyes can close. You don't have to do a thing but listen to me sing. I know you miss the world, the one you knew. The one where everything made sense because you didn't know the truth. That's how it works. Till the bottom drops out and you learn. We're all just hunters seeking solid ground. Don't stop trying to find me here amidst the chaos. Though I know it's blinding, there's a way out. Say out loud, we will not give up on love now. No fear, don't return like Orpheus, just stay here. Hold me in the dark, and when the day I'll show you good, restore your faith. I'll try and somehow make some meaning of the poison in this place. Convince you, love, don't breathe it in. You were written in the stars that we go swimming in, and it has no name, no guarantee. It's just the promise of a day I know that some will never see, but that's enough. If the bottom drops out, I hope my love was someone else's solid ground. Don't stop trying to find me here amidst the chaos. Though I know it's blinding, there's a way out. Say out loud, we will not give up on love now. No fear, don't you turn like Orpheus, just stay here. Hold me in the dark, and when the
I offer you as a benediction. These words from the Quaker theologian Rufus Jones. It takes immense faith to swing out thus from the main social current of the world on a unique venture, to make an experiment in the practice of love when everybody else insists that nothing will work but force. And like Bill just saying to us, I hope that when the bottom drops out, our love was someone else's solid ground. Will you join me in singing our closing hymn, There Is More Love Somewhere? Extinguish our chalices together as we recite our chalice extinguishing words. We extinguish this flame, but not the light of truth, the warmth of community, or the fire of commitment. These we carry in our hearts until we are together again. May it be so, friends. It was so good to be with you this morning. I invite you to stay as we go into breakout groups for coffee hour. If it's your first time with us or your 500th time or your 5,000th time, please stay and chat together this morning.